Good morning. My name is Maria Tiroir, and I will be your professor for the subjects on engines. I'm glad to be here to continue this first week of our sustainable mobility course. In the previous lessons, you have seen the context of the transport sector. It is important to fully understand this context before going into the technical details. So, this first lesson is going to be focused on the environmental context, pollution, and legislation. In the second part, we will discuss pollutant formation and give more details about pollution. We are constantly receiving information about climatic changes. The impact on human activities in these changes is a general concern, but the equation is not easy to solve. We would like to reduce the impact we have on the planet without dramatically changing our living standards. And of course, as you have seen in the previous lessons, it is impossible to forget the economic factor, which will be the driving force of the final solution. The transport sector is one of the main sectors contributing to certain pollutant emissions. But to understand why, we need to look at how the pollutants are produced in thermal engines. Oil is the energy most commonly used for transport. We will see next week how the oil is transformed into fuel. For now, you need to know that the fuels are molecules with a high content of carbon and hydrogen. In some cases, sulfur or oxygen can also be found in the fuel. Since the molecules are different in size, we use a general term to describe the chemical composition of the fuel. This is CXHYS. In thermal engines, the fuel reacts with the air during combustion. The air, as you know, is mainly composed of nitrogen and oxygen. So, what are the products of combustion? Well, there are quite a few. If combustion is complete, then carbon dioxide, nitrogen, and water are produced. If the fuel contains sulfur, then the sulfur reacts with oxygen to produce sulfur dioxide, or SO2. However, complete combustion is very rare. When combustion is not complete, in addition to CO2, nitrogen, and water, other products and gases are produced. The main ones, and I mean those which are produced in the highest concentration, are carbon monoxide, or CO, unburned hydrocarbons, or HC, nitrogen oxides, or NOx, and particulate emissions. Of course, there are many others, but let's keep it simple. These products are classified as pollutants because they produce a non-desired effect either on the environment or on people's health. This is why several emissions regulations have been developed in some countries. We will discuss emissions regulations in a few moments. The pollution's effect is different depending on the scale we are looking at. We can talk about local or global pollution. The difference is important because the risk, the influencing factors, and also the measures to control pollution will be different from one scale to another. When we talk about local pollution, we are referring to the pollution at the scale of a city. We might have a peak of local pollution for several hours or days. We've already seen episodes of high local pollution in cities like Paris, London, or Shanghai. Local pollution primarily affects people's health. Some of the pollutants coming from the transport sector contributing to the local pollution are CO, HC, NOx, and particulate emissions. In other words, the products of incomplete combustion. Global pollution refers to the planet's pollution. Global pollution concerns global warming. You all know that most of the global warming is being caused by increasing concentration of greenhouse gases produced by human activities. CO2 is commonly known as a greenhouse gas. It is important for you to understand that, since CO2 is a product of complete combustion, it is not regulated in the emissions legislation. Every time oil-based fuel is burned, CO2 is produced. Even though we cannot avoid producing CO2 out of combustion, what we can do is to try to reduce to the minimum possible the CO2 emissions. The amount of CO2 produced is directly proportional to the amount of fuel consumed by the car. This means that cars with lower fuel consumption produce less CO2 emissions. Some governments are forcing car manufacturers to produce cars with a lower fuel consumption. This is an important measure to reduce CO2 emissions. With the Kyoto Protocol, industrialized countries all over the world sign a treaty that sets binding obligations to reduce emissions of greenhouse gases. The goal is to prevent dangerous human-induced changes in the climate system. This graph shows the decreasing trend of CO2 emissions for all new cars sold throughout the years. The US is in green, Europe in blue, Japan in yellow, and China in red. As a consequence of the Kyoto Protocol, the transport sector in those countries has undertaken to reduce the average fleet's emissions of new cars sold. The goal in Europe is to achieve 95 grams of CO2 per kilometer in 2020 for the average fleet. The transport sector is one main contributor to greenhouse gases. In this graph, you can see an example of CO2 emissions in the atmosphere throughout the years in France. In red, you have the transport sector. CO2 produced by the transport sector is around 20% of the total emissions. You can see here the emissions of CO, NOx, and particulates emitted throughout the years in France by different contributors. Again, in red, you have the transport sector. You can see here that the part of those pollutants produced by the transport sector is very high. You can also see that there is a continuous reduction of the pollutant emissions over the years. This is a consequence of cleaner engine technologies introduced by car manufacturers as a response to emissions regulations. The emissions legislation includes not only specific emissions limits, but also specific driving cycles and test procedures. Laws on emissions are introduced successively in stages and limits are continuously decreasing. Let's see here the European example. The first stage of the emissions legislation was called Euro 1. It was introduced in 1992. The limits at that time are shown in red. At the end of 2014, the Euro 6 stage will be effective. This is shown in blue. As you can see, legislation becomes more stringent as time goes by. In the same way, many other countries have developed a legislation. There are three main legislations in the world that you can see on the map. The European, called Euro 1 to 6, the United States, called Tier 1 or 2, and the Japanese legislation. At present, each country follows one of those three regulations. You can see the countries following the European legislation are in different shades of blue. The countries following the US legislation are in different shades of brown. The Japan-based legislation is currently followed by Japan and is represented here in green. Not all the countries are at the same limits, but the goal is the same: to force the transport sector to produce cleaner vehicles. However, the problem is not that simple. Producing cleaner vehicles, of course, is going to help, but there are many other factors to take into account. To name two, we can mention the demographic factor and the average age of the fleet. You have already seen that the demographic explosion is going to increase the demand for mobility. So even if cars are cleaner, if the number of cars continues to increase, the pollutant emissions are going to increase too. In Europe and the US, the car market is pretty stable, but this is not the case in countries like Brazil, China, or India. Another important factor is that the emissions legislation only applies to new vehicles. The average age of the vehicle fleet is variable in each country. In Europe and the US, the average age is around 10 years. When we've seen how much the legislation has changed over time, you can understand that the efforts we make to produce new, cleaner cars are partly counterbalanced by the old cars that are still running. This is not an easy problem. So, that's it for this lesson. In the next lesson, we will continue to discuss pollutants emissions. Thanks for listening.